Hi, my name is Rawan Khassani. I'm from Jordan University of Science and Technology. I have a master's degree in biomedical sciences and I'm working currently at Princess Haya Biotechnology Center in the biotechnology field. And also I am a biorisk management instructor. I have received an intensive training at Sandia National Laboratories and I am also IFBA certified professional in biorisk management. Today we will talk about the biorisk characterization and evaluation. This lecture has been designed by Sandia National Laboratories and available on the GBRMC library. We will start first with the key messages. After the lecture today, you will be able to know what is the biological risk assessment. We will talk about the definition of the biological risk assessment, about the identification of hazards in evaluating the risk, determination of the likelihood and consequences, and about the risk characterization process, which should be a comprehensive process and also should be followed by the risk evaluation to decide whether the risk is accepted or not accepted, and decide what are the proper mitigation strategies that should be followed. What is a biological risk assessment? It is an analytical process where we identify the hazards or threat when we are working with the pathological agents or pathogens and toxins in the lab or at an institution. During the biological risk assessment, we determine the likelihood and consequences by gathering information about the factors that affect them. Also, this process should be comprehensive and it could be divided into two parts. The first one is the biosafety risk assessment, which talk about the unintentional safety risks that could happen during working with biological agents. The second one is the biosecurity risk assessment, which concern about the intentional security risks. Why we perform biological risk assessment? Usually we perform this process at the beginning of any work or when we have any change in our work, because we need to know what are the proper mitigation strategies that should be followed to reduce the risk of exposure or accidents or even the intentional exposure or misuse of biological agents. Before talking about the risk assessment, we need to understand what is risk. The risk is a combination of likelihood and consequences of undesirable events. So we can express risk as a function of likelihood or consequences, likelihood of harmful events and the consequences about the severity of that event. We can visualize risk in the two-dimensional graph where the y-axis represents the likelihood and the x-axis represents the consequences. We have a question now. What is the risk of being attacked by a tiger? It's a simple question, as you can see. But to answer this question, we have to be specific. We can't answer a very generic question like this one. So think in your mind. What do we need to know about the tiger or maybe the persons to be able to answer? Actually, there are many factors that we need to think about them. Some of these factors are related to the tiger itself. For example, we need to consider the age of the tiger, if it's hungry or not, the size of the tiger, the number of tigers, the location of the tiger, for example, if it's in the forest or in the cage. We also need to think about the person itself, whether the person is trained to handle the tiger, if the person has a gun, a weapon, for example, if he is alone or within a group, and maybe the age of the person, if he can run or not. We need to consider other factors, for example, the location, the distance between the tiger and the person, the presence of a hospital in the area. So to answer this question in a very accurate way, we need to collect information about many factors. We can't answer a very general question. To characterize risk, we need to be very specific. Now we will talk about several examples about the tiger, and we will try to determine the likelihood and the consequences and characterize the risk of this scenario. The first scenario, We have, you are in an open field next to a very hungry, aggressive adult tiger, and the tiger is unrestrained and sees you as a food. So what do you think in this scenario? What do you think is the likelihood? If we think about the likelihood, we think it would be high. Why? Because the tiger is aggressive, it's hungry, and you are unrestrained, and the tiger sees you as a food. So the likelihood of the attack is very high. Okay, let's think now about the consequences. The consequences also would be high, because the tiger is adult, it's not small tiger, also see you as a food, and he is aggressive. And once the attack happened, the consequences will be very harmful. So look to the graph and see where we represent the risk. The overall risk will be very high because the likelihood is high and also the consequences are high. Let's talk about the second scenario. You are now in the zoo observing a caged adult tiger, which is well-fed and has a mild temperament. To characterize risk, we always need to think about two things. The first thing, the likelihood. And here in this example, the likelihood will be low. Why? Because the adult, the tiger is in a cage. He is well-fed and mild temperament. So the likelihood of the attack by the tiger will be low. But what about the consequences? Although the likelihood is low, but the consequences, if the attack happened, still high. Because the tiger is adult, and if there is an attack, the consequences will be high. So the overall risk is low, because the likelihood is low, although the consequences are high. Let's talk about now the third example, the third scenario. You are holding a tiger cub with a playful temperament in your mind, in your arms. So what is the likelihood of attack in this scenario? The likelihood of attack in this scenario would be high, because you are playing with a tiger, and there is a high likelihood that the tiger will bite you. But what about the consequences? In this scenario, if the attack happened, the consequences would be low, because the tiger is a tiger cub and in mild temperament. So the overall risk is low, although the likelihood is high and the consequences are low. So in general, when we are talking about the risk assessment process, we can define this process or this procedure as analytical process. As you can see, when we talked about the tiger, we need to gather information, we need to characterize the likelihood, the consequences, and then we need to characterize risk and determine the level of risk, whether it's high, low, intermediate, or very high or very low. And we can use the graph, as we did before, to visualize risk using different isoquants or the curves. Now we can discuss the risk assessment strategy. And this strategy has been adopted from the CWA 15793-2011. Now, how do we usually should think about the risk? How we should start thinking? What is the first step? First, we have to describe the work activities. For example, if you are working at the lab, you need to determine what are the procedures that you are doing. Are you doing, for example, bacterial culture? Are you doing PCR? Are you doing extraction? Are you doing ELISA? The first thing that you have to do, describe the work activities. Then we will go to the next step, identifying the hazards. And here we mean by that to identify the type of the biological agents, the type of the bacteria or virus or toxin, for example. And if you are to doing biosecurity risk assessment, you need to identify the threats. After that, we need to determine the risk. And to determine the risk, we need to gather information, we need to determine the likelihood and the consequences, and determine what is the level of the risk. After that, we need to talk about or think about the risk acceptance. We have to ask ourselves this question. Decide whether or not the risk is acceptable. If the risk is acceptable, then proceed with your work and follow the appropriate control procedures. If the risk is not acceptable, then you have two options. The first one, to stop the work, or the second one, you can prepare your risk control mitigation plan and implement this plan, and then review the plan and check if it's working or not. After that, ask yourself the question again. Decide whether or not the risk is acceptable. If yes, then proceed. If no, you have to modify your plan or stop the work. This is, in general, the strategy that you usually follow to do the risk assessment process. Okay. Now we have another question, but now we are asking about the lab. The first question we asked about the tiger. Huh? What is the risk of being attacked by the tiger? Now we need to know or ask about the risk that we have or encountered at the lab. And to characterize the risk, we need to collect more information about the factors that affect risk. So, what are the factors that should be considered, whether in laboratory biosafety or biosecurity risk assessment? Okay. Now you have to think in many factors, and you have to be very comprehensive, because there are many, many factors affect the risk characterization process. For example, we will start with the agent properties. So you have to collect information about the pathogenicity of the agent, the virulence of the agent, the infectious dose, the route of exposure, the route of infection, the availability of therapy, the mortality and morbidity rate. This is the first thing, the agent properties. The second category, we need to collect information about the operational procedure. We need, for example, to determine what are the activities that are done in the lab. We need to also collect information about the decontamination and the waste management process. We need to collect information about the proper use of the biosafety cabinets. We need to collect also information about, for example, the shipping of the samples. So all the activities are done in the lab, we should be aware of these activities. The third category is the lab infrastructure. And here we mean the lab design, for example, the ventilations, the HVAC system, heating, ventilation, AC, the equipments, the availability of the biosafety cabinets, the centrifuge. We need to collect information about the design of the lab, like the floor or the ceiling, and other characteristics. The fourth category is the human factor. And here we mean that the persons or the workers at the lab. We need to know their background, their knowledge, their experience, their morale, and their workload also. And the immune system of them, because it's very important when we are characterizing the risk. And the fifth category is the environmental and community surrounding the lab. For example, the availability of the host or vector, the presence of bioterrorists around the lab, the density of population, the immune system of the population. All of these factors and many, many others affect the risk characterization process. So when we are doing the risk assessment, we have to collect all this information and even more. So why do we need this information? We use all of this information to determine the likelihood and the consequences. As you see in the tiger example, if I ask you the question in general, what is the risk of being attacked by the tiger, you can't answer me because it's very, very general. We need to be more specific. We need to know where's the tiger, what is the situation, who will be attacked. And this is the same thing happened in the lab. I can't ask you, for example, what is the risk of being attacked, of getting infected in the lab. You can't answer me like this. You need more information. You need to know, for example, what are the pathogens that are that the lab working with? What are the activities? Who is working? What about the lab infrastructure, the design, using the cabinet, using the HEPA filters, and many, many other information. And this, we call this process the risk characterization. And as I told you, it's the determination of the likelihood and consequences, and determining the level of risk, whether it's low, medium, or high. And it's very important to know that we cannot characterize a general risk. The risk should be very specific, very particular, to be able to characterize the risk accurately. It's very important when we are characterizing the risk to determine two important things. The first one is the hazard. What do we mean by hazard? The hazard is the source of unintentional risk. For example, the pathogen itself could be a hazard. When we are working, for example, with the hepatitis B samples, the hepatitis B virus is the hazard because it could be a source of unintentional risk. And usually we use the term hazard in the biosafety context. The threat is the source of intentional risk. For example, if there are bioterrorists around the lab, they are the threat. If there are, for example, foreign people who get access to the lab and intend to misuse the samples, they are the threat. We usually use the term threat with biosecurity context. So when we are doing risk characterization, we need to determine the hazard and the threat in each situation. Also, it's very important when we are characterizing the risk to determine the situation. And what do you mean by situation? The conditions that surround the hazard, the threat, and the workers. Now we'll discuss these two scenarios about the biosafety and biosecurity risk and talk more about the likelihood, the consequences, and the situation. The first scenario. In the first scenario, there is a lab worker has just prepared a culture of Mycobacterium tuberculosis in order to conduct a drug sensitivity test. He is wearing gloves, surgical mask, and lab coat, and using a biosafety cabinet, which has not been certified in 3 years. Let's answer the first question. What is the hazard in this scenario? As you can see, the hazard here, the bacteria, the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. This is the source of risk. The second question. What is the likelihood of exposure? What is the likelihood that the worker could get infection from this bacteria? Now, to answer this question, we need to use the information provided in the scenario. As you can see, about the PPE, about the personal protective equipment, he is wearing gloves, surgical mask, and lab coat. And in this case, because the Mycobacterium tuberculosis transmitted by inhalation, the surgical mask, it will not work. He needs to wear a respirator with a HEPA filter. So this wearing the surgical mask making the likelihood high. The second thing is the biosafety cabinet. The worker is working in a biosafety cabinet which has not been certified in the last 3 years, which means the cabinet maybe it's not working properly. These two things and also the route of the transmission of this bacteria, because it's transmitted by inhalation and the infectious dose is very low, it's one cell that can cause infection. All of these factors make the likelihood very high. Now, let's talk about the consequences. What are the consequences of exposure? And here when we are talking about the consequences, we need to think about the agent itself, the Mycobacterium tuberculosis. As you know, there is no cure. The infection remains in the body, and the bacteria. He is doing a drug sensitivity testing, so there is a chance that the bacteria is drug resistant, which make the consequences worse. So, in this scenario, the likelihood is high, and the consequences also are high. And now, to characterize the risk, we can visualize the risk on the graph. Look to the star. Because the likelihood is high and the consequences are high, the overall risk is high. So what are the some factors that should be considered? When we are talking about the likelihood, we need to consider factors like the agent itself, the infectious dose. We need to consider factors in the lab, the operational factors, as we said, using of inappropriate PPE, the biosafety cabinets. We need to think about all of these factors. For the consequences, we need to think about the agent itself, the severity of infection, and the worker. But here in this scenario, we don't have information about the worker immune system or health status. But we can characterize the risk as high in this scenario. And the scenario is about biosafety risk, because the risk here is unintentional. The risk of exposure is unintentional. In the second scenario, the same lab worker discovers that his culture of Mycobacterium tuberculosis is extremely drug resistant. Meanwhile, a local animal rights group has threatened to disrupt laboratory operations and generate publicity by breaking in and stealing agents. They believe that taking samples of XDR will generate the most publicity. In this case, we are facing an intentional risk, and the threat in this scenario is the animal rights group, because he is trying or threatened to disrupt the laboratory and steal the agent. So what is the likelihood of the theft? To answer this question, we need to think about the situation. Where here we have the lab, we don't have an exact or accurate information about the security measures, but we can expect that this lab, they are not following the good or precaution. They are not using the proper PPE, and the cabinet are not certified. And these actions give a clue that this lab also do not have a good security measures. We think that this lab don't have, for example, access control, and maybe the foreigners can go inside the lab and steal the sample easily. So we think that the likelihood in this example is high. Let's talk about the consequences. And again, when we answer this question, we need to think about the agent. And as we said before, the infection will be severe. There is no cure, and the bacteria is drug resistant, which make the consequences high. And also because the animal rights group, they want to steal the samples because, to do publicity. And there is a high chance that they don't know how to handle the samples. So maybe they will make a huge exposure to these samples to public, even without intention. So the likelihood is high, and the consequences is high, and the overall risk also is high. So, and what are the factors that should be considered? We talked about the agent factors, the operational factors, also the community factors. It's very important to understand that the hazard itself or threat itself without a situation do not pose a risk. Why? Because, for example, if we have a pathological agent, if we have the Mycobacterium tuberculosis, but this bacteria present in other building and we are not doing any work with this bacteria, then there's no risk because there's no situation. We are not handling the bacteria. It's the same in the example of the tiger. If there is a tiger, but the tiger in another country, and here we don't have a tiger. Although the tiger is a hazard, but in this situation, in this case, because there is no situation, no contact with the tiger, it cannot pose any risk. So the risk to be happened, we need to have both the hazard and the situation in case of unintentional risk, in the biosafety risks, and we need to have the threat and the threat and situation in case of intentional risk and the security risk. So it's very important when we are doing the risk characterization to identify these three things: hazard, threat, and situation. Now, any change in the hazard or a threat or situation will change the characterization of the risk. For example, in the if the Mycobacterium tuberculosis is not drug resistant, the consequences will be lower, and the overall risk will be lower. Also, if we are changing the situation, for example, if the lab worker use a cabinet, a certified cabinet, the likelihood of exposure will be lower, so the overall risk will decrease. So any change in the hazard or threat or the situation will change the characterization of the risk. We have several tools that can help us to characterize risk. One of them is the BioRAM. The BioRAM is the Biosafety and Biosecurity Risk Assessment Methodology. It is a software developed by Sandia National Laboratories in collaboration with international experts. They design the software by generating questions. These questions asking about the agent properties, the operational properties, and you have to answer a large set of questions. And after that, the BioRAM itself can give you the graph where you can see the likelihood and the consequences. So this BioRAM, this software, is available online and could be used to characterize risk. But the BioRAM cannot do the risk evaluation. So the risk evaluation is the next step after the risk characterization. Now, in the risk evaluation, we are interrupting the and explaining and using the result of risk characterization to make a decision about the mitigation measures. In risk evaluation, we are asking ourselves this question: is the characterized risk accepted or not? And what to do next? So here we are deciding whether it's high, low, or medium, and decide if it's acceptable or not. Unfortunately, there's no systemic way to evaluate risk, because each one of us can evaluate the same risk in the same way. The evaluation of the risk or acceptance of the risk depends on many factors. It depends on the individuals, it depends on the institution, and in the community. And there are many factors that affect the risk acceptance or the risk evaluation. For example, the culture. Some of the research experiments are not accepted by the community because it's against their culture and their religion, for example. Also, the risk evaluation depends on the experience. For example, if the worker hasn't experience with working, for example, with a high-risk pathogen, maybe he refused to do the work. He is not able to do the work, so he will not accept that. Also, it depends on the resources of the institution. If they have, for example, budget to prepare the lab, to buy a cabinet, to do the certification. So, and this is affect the decision of risk acceptance. Also, it depends on the management. And this is very important because the final decision about the risk acceptance usually done by the management. And it's also affected by the regulations, the laws that present in the country. And it's not only the country. We are not talking only about the institutional regulations. We are talking about national regulations and international regulations. All of these things affect the decision about the risk acceptance. Now, only as we said before, only the institution can determine or the level of risk, if it's low, high, moderate. And each institution can evaluate the same risk in a different way. For example, the same risk could be evaluated as high in one institution, and they spend resources and time and money to mitigate risk. In another institution, they could consider the same risk as moderate, for example, or low, and they don't need to do any mitigation because there are many factors, as we said before, affect their decision and their acceptance. But in case that the institution consider the risk is unacceptable, then they need to do more mitigation measures, to spend more resources, to train, for example, their employees, to provide more equipment, to upgrade their labs. But if they don't see it as unacceptable, if they see it as acceptable risk, they don't need to do any mitigation measures, for example. But still, it's not only about the institution. The community, as we said before, has a great role in this process, because the community's risk acceptability level will affect the institution work. Because in certain situations, if the community surrounding the institution they don't accept, for example, as we said, the research projects that the institution are doing, they can't stop their work. So the community have a role in this risk acceptance process. But as we said before, the final decision is up to the institution. Now, how we can depict the risk evaluation on the likelihood and the consequences graph? As you can see, there are curves separated the very low to low, moderate, high, very high regions. These curves called isoquants, which means that the risk in any of these curves, the isoquants, are the same. But you have to know that the location of these isoquants are very arbitrary. The location of these isoquants could be different from one institution to another. It depends on their risk acceptance. It depends on their perception and how they see risk. To explain that in more details, we will talk about the risk averse and the risk tolerant. Okay. The risk averse, we said that this institution is risk averse, for example, when they don't like the risk, when they see the risk is high, when they spend more mitigation, more resources and time to do the mitigation measures because they see the risk is unacceptable and they need to mitigate risk. white risk tolerant, those who are people who like risk, who see that the risk is not high, maybe medium or low. So they didn't, they don't usually spend resources or time to mitigate risk. And you can see in the graph here, for example, the first graph, you can see the risk in the default situation. In the second graph, you can see the risk averse. It's the same characterized risk. You can see the star in the same position. But for example, the risk averse person will see the risk is very high, and he thinks that he needs to spend time and effort, resources to mitigate risk. While the risk tolerant person or the institution see the same risk as very low. So they think that they don't need to do any mitigation measures, for example. So as we said, the risk evaluation, risk averse institution see the risk is high, and they spend time, mitigate resources to mitigate risk. But similar institution with the same risk, who tolerate risk, will spend no time and no resources to mitigate the risk, because they see they see risk as not dangerous. Now at the end of the lecture, there's an assignment. Please do the assignment, and thank you.